Okay, welcome to part 3 of Excel best practices. We are going to cover analytics related best practices. The first part was about data management. Second best practices were about formulas. And third one, analytics. So let's get started. The first thing most people don't know about pivot table is when you create a pivot table, a copy of the entire data is kept inside the pivot table. That's called pivot table cache. It does not occupy exactly the same amount of space. It does get compressed, typically 50% of space. So the moment you create a pivot table, your file size is increased 50%. Remember that. The second thing, I create one pivot table from the data. Now I go to the data again, create another pivot table. That's additional 50%. So if you want multiple pivot tables from the same data, create one pivot table, copy that pivot table, paste it, and then customize it. Now we have still one copy of the data. So because the copy is created and you know that your raw data is not going to change till next month, you can actually delete the raw data. Pivot table will still run without a problem and file size will reduce. Another common bad habit people have is to put formulas outside pivot table. But many people have no idea that what they are trying to do by putting formula outside pivot can be done by pivot itself. One is right-click in the data area, look at show values as and summarize by. Maybe whatever you are trying to do outside happens here itself. For example, I want a running total. This is the way to do it. If I want a percentage difference from previous items, so typically month-on-month, year-on-year growth or decline, this is the way to do it. So very powerful set of options are already available. Second, many times we need calculations across these columns. Columns are called fields. So we have something called calculated fields. So here I have amount, I have discount, and I have net amount. Now you calculate the net amount outside, it's going to trouble you because anytime it expands, it's going to get overwritten. But if I go to calculated fields and create that formula, that is a part of pivot table. And it adjusts to whatever you do to the pivot table. If you add something more in rows or columns, is going to expand. The best part about calculated fields is the original fields are no longer required. You can remove them, calculation will still happen. And if you change the structure of the pivot table by adding something in rows or columns, it will still calculate properly. The other aspect is calculated items. This is a lesser known item because actually when you go to the menu, it's always inactive or disabled. Why is that? Because in order for that menu to be active, we have to understand what is an item. Click inside any of the item, then the menu gets activated. So in this example, month is the field and individual month are the items. So click on one of the month. Now the menu is active and now you can put a formula. So I want to say Jan plus Feb plus March is equal to Q1. Okay, put that formula. Again, same story. I can remove Jan, Feb, March, just keep Q1. Everything will work as expected. So a combination of calculated fields and calculated items gets away from all sorts of formulas outside the pivot. One of the things I've seen people do is, I've created a pivot table, but that's not my final report. My final report is somewhere else. I'm going to take some data from this pivot, some data from that pivot, and put it there. So, okay, that's fine. But when you refer to data from pivot table somewhere outside, it's very dangerous because generally you're just going to say equal to cell reference. Don't do that. Click equal to wherever you want the final report to be, then click inside the data cell, it'll generate a get pivot data statement. Don't ignore it. It's a very powerful function, very important function, because get pivot data is the only way to get accurate data from pivot table. If you just put a cell number and change pivot table structure, it will show you some number, but that is not the number you wanted. You will not even get an error message. On the other hand, get pivot data does not bother about the structure and layout of the pivot table. It knows this is the pivot table, this is the value, this is the field, and it's precise. So precise reference to Excel pivot table data means get pivot data. Creating multiple get pivot data statements one by one is really boring and inefficient, but don't worry, I've already created a macro for that. The details, download link, all of that is in the description. Another very common pivot table related activity is people put something in a filter area. For example, I have put type of card in filter area, gold, platinum, whatever. Now I have created some analysis, I have four people each handling one type of credit card. So now I will filter it on Platinum. That report I want to send to Platinum product manager. Again, I'll filter on Gold. I want to send only that report to the Gold product manager. The problem with that approach is what? If that person says all, then Gold person is seeing Platinum data and vice versa. We know that is going to happen. So most people just copy paste this pivot table as values and send. Now security is maintained, but that other person can't analyze data. That person is the product manager, should have the ability to analyze data. So this is done using a macro which I have written. Download it, use it, and you will love it. While analyzing pivots, people know what to put in rows, what to put in columns, but there's also something called recommended pivots, which does use some kind of algorithm in AI. Just eyeball it and see something useful comes or not. Very often, people spend a lot of time customizing the look and feel of charts. If you are doing that, customize it once, right-click, save it as a chart template, and next time you can use it without manual work. Even if you have finished making all the reports, you're not sure whether you have looked at all the useful things from the data. Who is going to tell you? AI is the answer. So now Excel has an AI feature to analyze your data. So go to the raw data, click on this button called Analyze Data. If you don't see that button, that means you don't have the correct version of Excel. It is available in Office Pro Plus versions of Excel. Then it gives you a list of reports to look at. Some of them are pivot tables, some of them are pivot charts. Now, all that you have to do is just look at them. Of course, some of them you may already be making. Fine, no problem. Move on. Just eyeball them. Think, do I already know this? Skip. No? Oh, interesting. Yes. Then it's an opportunity. Like that, every time the data changes, click on that button, eyeball the reports, and take action when necessary. Very, very useful thing. And just above these reports, there is a question answer text box as well. Just type the question. Look at them, and of course you can type your own questions. So I am typing a question saying how many cities are there. It gives me the answer. I can even have more complex question like give me top 3 cities based on average amount. It does that also and gives you an option to insert that pivot table and analyze it further. Now finally, when all the analysis is done, usually we copy paste these things into PowerPoint and send, or we send the files themselves to each other. So try not to send files as attachments. Put them in OneDrive, Teams or SharePoint and share them as links. That saves everyone the trouble. And if you have a large Excel file which takes a long time to open, try opening it on browser. It's much faster. If you just want to look at a report and interact with it, might as well do it faster on the browser. Now finally, if you have not seen the first part about best practices data related, second part about formula best practices, have a look at them as well. So that's it for now. Thank you.